conversation. I'm going to pass off the floor to Nina, Robert, and Naomi real quick. They're going to introduce themselves and their work and tell you a little bit about how their work relates to intimacy. Then we're going to jump over into a conversation section where we'll be asking questions and having a dialogue, and that should run us right through the end of the session. And just to very briefly tell you about me so you have some context, I'm Bonnie Ruberg. I work at USC in interactive media and games, and I work on LGBT issues and games. Over to Nina.
Yeah, we're each doing like brief little 5-minute presentations about our stuff to give you context for why we're here. So my name is Nina Freeman, and I'm going to hit start on this PowerPoint. Yeah. So you might be wondering why I'm here on a panel about intimacy, so I'll give you a little background on some of the stuff I worked on and how intimacy applies to my design practice. So in my personal work, I most often make games based on my own life. So based on a true story or autobiographical, however you want to refer to it. And in general, I strive to create characters that are honest, characters that feel like they could be your neighbor or a friend or someone who you just meet on the street, just ordinary people, even if their life in fiction is quite different from your own. And I want to write believable characters that feel like they're the kinds of characters that you can understand and get close to. I try to help players feel like they can intimately understand characters by giving them the context and the mechanics through which they can embody the character. So, for example, I worked on this game called How Do You Do It, and one of my collaborators, Tim, is in the audience. And in this game, I put players in the shoe of myself as a child when I was trying to figure out how sex works by playing pretend with my dolls by like banging them together like this. I didn't really know how sex worked. Yeah. So it was like this. So in How Do You Do It, the player is able to move around this character's hands, stepping into her shoes for a moment, banging the Barbie dolls together, and coming closer to her experience through the motions of the dolls and through the context presented. So I was talking about player character embodiment before, so I'm going to like talk a bunch about that. So embodiment can't simply occur by letting the players just press the keys on the keyboard. Obviously, it's more complicated than that. So, in order to help the player embody a character, the mechanics need to be contextualized before the player can step into the character's shoes, I think. There's the mechanical context of matching the dolls together, which brings the player physically closer to the experience of being this girl. And then there's some non-mechanical context presented through her internal monologue in the corner, which you can see on the screen. And through opening and closing cutscenes that show her mother going to and from the store, so you can kind of understand why she's doing this. Which is because her mom went out to the store and she's like, now I'm alone and I can think about sex. So I tried to give the player enough context to understand who the girl is and how she feels in that moment, so that there's more to the mechanics than just the button pressing. In addition to contextualizing the mechanic, it was important that we show her face. And that we make it clear that the player is playing a specific character that is not themselves. Specificity, I think, is key if you want a player to embody a character that isn't meant to be themselves. If they don't have a clear understanding of the character they're meant to be embodying and playing as, they'll probably just project themselves onto the character instead. Instead of becoming intimate with the character and trying to understand their life experience. Contextualizing both the mechanics and the character as a character are key to helping a player become intimate and embody a character. So I'm also working on this game called Sybil, which you should come play the demo of. It's in the digital select tents, and it's coming out on November 2nd, so please get it. But I'm going to use this as another example. So in this game, I'm also trying to help the player become intimate and embody a character. And similarly, how do you do it? The player has to be me. So in Sybil, you play as me at 19. And in the game, me, aka the character, has become close with a young man that she met in an online game. So you embody Nina's experience becoming close with her lover in this online game as they chat and play together until they decide to meet up to have sex. So I try to help the player embody Nina by sitting them down at her desktop first. That's sort of the first thing that happens in the game. You see like a little cutscene of me sitting at my computer, like clicking around, and then it very quickly cuts straight to the desktop. So you're sort of like presented with this third person view, and then you're asked to like sit in the chair and like play as her, like moving her mouse around and going through her files and stuff. So the player may also log into her online game and play as her using her avatar and listening to the conversation she has with her lover. Because like I said before, like specificity is really important to this kind of player character embodiment, because if the player isn't like clear about what the character they're playing as is like all about and like what their motivations are, then it's hard to kind of like embody that character because they don't understand it, and that confusion can kind of get in the way of the experience of embodiment. So the conversations, when you're hearing them talk, they're meant to give enough context for the player to understand what Nina might be feeling and thinking about this guy that she's playing with. And also why they would even be clicking around and playing the online game. So the context of who Nina is and seeing what she looks like, reading through her personal blog posts and poems, all work to contextualize the character and the mechanics of using her computer and playing this online game and clicking around. So these aspects all sort of work together to help the player embody Nina through this game, becoming intimate with her particular life experience. So understanding and accepting another person's life experience is one of the most intimate things I think you can do. And through these games, I strive to help the player consider how the character feels and why they feel that way, what it's like to be them, to feel close to them during the game and even after. I'm really interested in embodiment as a form of intimacy because I want players to become intimate with me and my life experience. I want to help them break down their expectations of what it's like to be me and to show them what it's actually like from my perspective. I want players to come away from these games with the feeling that they became close to me and are able to also intimately understand me through the mechanics and context presented in these games. So that's all I got. And now I'll pass it to Robert. Thank you.
Thanks, Nina. Okay. Hey, I'm Robert Yang, and there's my Twitter, if you want to tweet about me or something. I teach at NYU Game Center and Parsons New School for Design, New York City, and I've been making video games for a while. And for lack of a better term, only recently, in this maybe like past year, I've started making games about gay sex. this game's called Hurt Me Plenty. In this game, you spank this like hunky dude, but you also kind of, before you spank, you also have to negotiate how to play out the scene with him. You know, what his safe word is, does he want it really soft or does he want it really hard? And then after the spanking, you also do some aftercare and, you know, kind of caress him and listen to his feelings and listen to how he felt the scene played out. I want to confront players with kind of this vulnerability, with this NPC making themselves vulnerable to you. And if you like abuse that trust that NPC places with you, the NPC will actually refuse to play with you for several weeks and lock you out of the game because you're a jerk and who wants to get spanked by a jerk. So to me, that's kind of what intimacy is about, kind of that kind of like trust and respecting boundaries. Then this game is called Succulent. Succulent is kind of a different game. In this game, you help the kind of the same hunk, technically, eat a popsicle, which I feel is pretty straightforward. As you do this, he kind of hypnotizes you over time and then eventually devours you. It's modeled off some of these, what do they call, like, homo hop music videos, artists like Caswell, where there are kind of these music videos about putting these like beefy, sweaty dudes kind of like in the middle, and it's just really clear what they're about, and they're like a delivery mechanism for like beefy sweatiness, which is really cool. And Succulent's probably one of the more like overtly sexual games. There's a lot of moaning and like sucking noises. I also implemented like cheek physics, so like if you like poke it into his mouth, you know, his cheeks kind of bulge out, which is kind of fun. So this game's kind of about the intimacy of like bodies and exploring someone else's body, kind of. Then I made another game called Stick Shift. Stick Shift is more about innuendo, I would say. In it, you basically give a gay car a handjob. I used to say it was autoerotic. But then dudes would like mansplain to me, that's not what autoerotic means. So patriarchy is not only harmful, but also unimaginative and annoying. So, thank you. Stick Shift is also kind of the hardest game I made. You actually have to require precise timing to shift your car up from first gear to like fifth gear, and it's modeled off of, you know, like actually like make sure RPMs are at the right amount and stuff. So it's like a little bit realistic. There's a huge video tutorial community on YouTube for this game. A lot of people like cosplaying it. And if you do it correctly, you bring both the driver and the car to climax. And then you have to wait 10 to 20 minutes for your refractory period to be over before playing good. If you don't know what a refractory period is, ask your parents. Next. Cobra Club. Cobra Club is a dick pic photo studio game. I was inspired a lot by this really excellent Tumblr called Critique My Dick Pic, as well as a lot of debates around the time about NSA surveillance and the Patriot Act. In the form of CanTheySeeMyDick.com. So I recommend both of those sites. Ask your parents first, though. So in this game, you take a lot of dick pics, and you can kind of put like Instagram filters on them and put like cool stickers and sparkles on them and stuff too. You can also like adjust your girth and length and everything and your ball size. It's very user-friendly. And in it, you also chat with fellow members, and they will ask to see your dick pic, or you can ask to see their dick pic, and you can say yes or no, so it's kind of this ideal consent kind of thing, where dick pics are this purely beautiful thing that you only send with someone's consent. And while you're doing all this, the game is also secretly sending the dick pics you create to a fictional state spy agency. It's actually a server I set up on Tumblr. So eventually the NPCs get upset that you've been leaking their photos onto the internet, even though it's not your fault, but it kind of is, I guess. And then you violated their trust and they ban you from chat and refuse to talk to you ever again. So Cobra Club kind of argues that dick pics, much like democracy, require privacy and respect, and warrantless mass surveillance destroys both. And then this is the most recent game I've made, Rinse and Repeat. It's the most technologically advanced male shower simulator ever made. So in this game, you wash this guy, but you can only wash him at certain parts of the day in real life, like after a gym class. The gym has like a schedule that's chained to your computer's system clock. So I wanted players to kind of like anticipate washing him, like set a reminder in their phone, wash man, watch virtual man. And then once you actually do get there at the right time, you have to scrub him, and he says, oh, scrub my ass. Then you scrub his ass and something, and go like, no, that's too hard. So then you have to scrub softer. I want the player to be basically submissive to the game, kind of more, where you have to mold your life around the game instead of the game kind of accommodating you more. So maybe that's what intimacy is about, kind of letting yourself go to someone else. And then here's a top secret world exclusive preview of the next gay sex game, a track mode, tentatively. It's like Journey plus Spy Party with gay sex. It's a virtual gay club with like 100 sexy dudes, and you have to find the one other human player there. And you forge a connection with them, and it's gonna be like VR, but to walk around, you have to look at butts. So when you look at the butt, you move toward the butt. And sometimes there won't be another human there, I think. And then you'll feel like your night is wasted and everyone in the club will ignore you, which is very realistic, maybe. So maybe that's too realistic, I don't know. So basically this is kind of like my method. I like starting with a fantasy kind of rooted firmly in the culture outside of games, which right now is a lot of gay sex. Or like having sex in your car or something, and then you explore the consequences. So in Stick Shift, there's actually a random percentage that the cops will stop you and do a traffic stop on you as you're trying to jack off your car. And your crime is basically driving while gay, and it's supposed to feel kind of random and unfair, but that's kind of part of the weirdness about sexualizing driving, and driving has all these politics associated with it, so I wanted to explore that. And then I give away the game for free and make no money from it. I'm very successful at making very little money, so that's great. And basically, I just feel like a lot of people kind of want my games to be like porn, and I kind of make them look like porn, so I guess I can't blame them. And porn is really great, but I think porn is also kind of like fast and easy, and it tells us these really beautiful lies about how sex and relationships work. And I think like sex is also full of this awkwardness and weirdness, right? Like it's really beautiful if you fantasize about like having sex in the forest or something, right? And then there's like birds chittering around you and stuff. I want to be the rock poking in your back as you have sex in the forest, and it feels really awkward and painful. I want to explore kind of like this, the discomfort, and that's kind of what my games all kind of try to do. And that's me, I guess.
Hey, is this one on? Yeah, hey. So I'm Naomi. I'm also interested in discomfort. So this is a close-up of one of the cards from Consenticle, which is the game that I have here at IndieCade this year. And it's just one of a few games about intimacy, sex, and related topics that I've worked on for most of my career, and I've been making games for way too long now, maybe like 20 years. I should probably be recycled soon. But most of the games I've worked on that are not about sex, right, unsurprisingly. And they're mostly games I've worked on in teams, whereas the games that I'm going to tell you about right now are some of the very few games that I've done entirely by myself. And I mostly worked on video games, but I found that these topics are actually really interesting to explore in non-digital games, games that you're playing together with someone else who's sitting right in front of you. So the first game of this kind that I worked on was actually maybe about 10 years ago, and I did it inadvertently, and I didn't publish it till recently. It was called Sex Mix, and I came up for this game with this game when I was lying in bed with an ex with whom I used to do this thing where we would try to gross each other out and one-up each other. So this game is kind of what resulted from that, from talking about mood music and how terrible some kinds of cheesy mood music is. The idea is basically that you collaboratively put together a playlist, but you're trying to put songs in it that will throw your partner totally out of the mood. Right, so you might start off easy, you know, just put some like cheesy 80s R&B in there, or some Enya, like anything that Enya's going to do. You know, make somebody make a face, and then you ramp up until you put like real killers in there, like us. 76 trombones, kind of Daniel Sousa march music, or Mr. Rogers' theme song is a real winner in this game. So you're trying not to get knocked out. So this game is kind of about making sex much worse, more difficult, which you'd think would be a bad thing, and it is. But you know, if you consensually play this game, it's also an exploration of awkwardness of how we're expected to just fall so easily into this, like, oh, we're together, it's so beautiful, wonderful, and intimate, like in the forest that Robert just described. But of course, it's not that easy, and that's kind of what I'm interested in. That's the, maybe the personal part of myself that I put into these games, since I don't make autobiographical games, but my games do express my feelings about the topics that I'm designing around, right? So the awkwardness, to me, is not just an obstacle that we should just try to get past. We don't want to talk about that, or, you know, we hope that it just goes away. It's part of the point, is to be sweaty and nervous and uncomfortable and scared and have your heart race and not feel sure about what's going on. So I think games are actually an interesting way to pull some of that out and let us look at it and laugh about it and play with it. So that takes me to Consenticle. Now this game had a long germination process. It kind of started maybe all the way back in the late 90s, early 2000s, when tentacle porn and hentai first arrived in this country, to the shock and horror of a lot of people. And as a Japanese American, I quickly grew really sick of the stereotype that Japanese culture, like it was a mainstay of Japanese culture somehow, right? That tentacle porn was this part, like a huge part of the, like, oh, Japan, it's so weird. People over there are so weird. Everything is strange. So I've been irritated about that for a really long time. And then I got even more irritated when tentacle rape finally showed up as a theme in games a couple years ago, when I noticed this Kickstarter for a game called Tentacle Bento, which was doing what to me was absolutely the wrong way to import and talk about tentacle rape or hentai erotica in games. It just duplicated all of the problems and stereotypes associated with the anime genre, imported them into games, really just for shocks and giggles. And so in this game, you play a tentacled monster of an unspecified kind, and the goal is to capture girls, which was pretty clear from the way the developers talked about it. It was a thinly veiled euphemism for rape, because, you know, they were like, oh, we're doing a parody of tentacle porn, and everybody knows what that's about, right? So this made me start thinking, like, well, does it really have to be this way? If you were going to make a game about tentacles, couldn't you do something different? Couldn't you rehabilitate that somehow? Because even though I'm not particularly interested in tentacle hentai as a genre, I am interested in tentacles. As a queer person, I think it's really interesting to talk about and play around with ideas about alternate forms of bodies, alternate genitals, genital alternatives, I guess I'll just propose as a category. And and how people with very different experiences of their bodies relate to each other and are able to be intimate. And then I got an opportunity to actually bring that game idea into floor existence through the No Quarter exhibition of games that we have in New York City, which this year was curated by Robert, actually. But Consenticle was part of that exhibition last year, and I started working on it more in earnest and took a lot of inspiration from unlikely games like Netrunner, which is a very nerdy collectible card game with a cyberpunk theme. But the way that some players talked about it, like Maddie Bryce is here in the audience, made it clear to me that there's actually something really interesting and intimate and flirtatious going on in this game. And then I looked at other games that are collaborative, like Hanabi, where you don't actually know what you're holding in your hand. You have to rely on trust and communication with other players in order to solve a problem together. So those things all kind of blended together to create the idea for Consenticle, where you have two players, much like a trading card game. And one player plays a human being who's curious about what it might be like to have a sexual encounter with the other player who's playing a tentacled alien. So in Consenticle, like a lot of two-player dueling card games, you have a resource economy. So players have tokens, which are called trust tokens. And that's one of the cool things about representation in games, is that you can just put names on things, and then suddenly, oh, it means something different. We have to figure out how to each invest our tokens, which represent trust, into a common space, which in this game I call the intimacy pool. And then you can then turn a pair of red and blue tokens into a purple token, which is called a satisfaction token. And that's basically the mechanic of the game. Rather than being a duel competitively, it's a collaborative game where you have to figure out how to go through this process as efficiently as possible in a limited amount of time, which are represented by turns that you take, where every turn you are drawing and playing a card from a deck that lets you do a number of things with this little system of trust and intimacy. You can play some cards to get tokens, others to sort of move them into this pool. Other types of cards combine the tokens together, take them out, which is really the goal of the game, to try and see how many of these purple tokens you can make. And then there are other cards that let you sort of repeat and amplify that process. So what I was trying to get at here is actually the way that when we're trying to figure out how to trust each other, how to communicate, how to be intimate, it's not just a matter of flipping a switch on and saying, hey, yeah, I'm ready to do that, right? That's part of the joke in, say, like the old SNL sketch with Will Ferrell and Rachel Dratch playing this sort of hippie couple that they refer to each other as, oh, yes, you're my lover. It's so wonderful that we're here together in the hot tub. That they're able to just go there immediately, skipping over all of the awkwardness and process and things that we might have to negotiate with each other. So Considical very deliberately has this gamey system that's standing between the two players. It's kind of obstructing you from just being together. And that's on purpose, right? Because in games, system often is something that does bring us together. It provides us a reason for us to interact with each other, some sort of structure that we can figure out how to approach each other through. And at the same time, it's the thing that's keeping us apart. So that paradox there, the polarity between those two things, the fact that, you know, all of the rules and messing around with these tokens is both a device and a barrier. It's something that we have to figure out how to solve if we really want to have a human connection. But would we even be able to do it if it wasn't there, if we just pretended like there was no awkwardness? Maybe not. Okay, and so that wraps it up for our presentations. And oh, yeah, you can play Consentical starting later today at the Firehouse. Came out of working in games for a long time and just feeling like games were lying about intimacy. But there are all of these games, even going back to sports, right? There's this old adage that I didn't used to understand when I was a kid about football players and how it's like, oh, football players touch each other on the butt. I don't even know if that's a thing anymore, but when I was a kid, that was something that people talked about for a lot for some reason. And like, well, that's okay because they're football players, right? But there's something actually super interesting interactions happening all the time when people are competing, when they're grappling with each other, insert your favorite nasty joke about locker rooms or wrestling or whatever. But it doesn't just have to be at that giggly innuendo level, right? When you, I've seen so many people play games with each other and have these intense emotional experiences that are a little bit covered up, right? By this idea that, well, we're not really having a close emotional encounter here. We're in this separate space. We're playing a game, so it's not really a big deal that I'm like staring at you really intensely in this way that would be super weird if we were just drinking coffee in a cafe. And I think it takes the insightful analysis of someone like Maddie looking at Netrunner and saying, well, this is actually like a really kind of flirtatious, like a persona can come out through that where I'm backstabbing you, like a lover betraying you, to expose the fact that that's going on in a trading card game, right? But we pretend that that's not happening, right? That it's just this, it's this cold, abstract thing where, we don't have to look at each other, we're just moving our cards around, we're engaging in this abstract, mathematical, like highbrow strategy, and try to ignore all of the human elements. So I was like, no, let's like rip that facade aside. I think that was my impulse, because it's like, then that actually opens up so much more happening behind the scenes if we stop pretending that games aren't like, sort of like taking drugs and sort of like having sex.
Hello? Should I not be turning the mic off? I thought that was like a courtesy thing. Anyway, I actually really like that part of consentical. I think like if you're charming, you are good at consentical probably, right? And that's kind of interesting, right? Like, I think a lot of games, you'd be like, oh, you're charming? No, you're not a real player or gamer. You're cheating, right, by being charming or interesting or something.
Well, it's interesting because it's true. Like, being charming, it works in any game where you can, if you can convince someone to work with you, right? The formalist definitions. It's a game with player politics. There's more than three sides, and you can convince someone to team up with you against the third person, and then you get all these dynamics like betrayal and so forth. So personality and like your relationships from outside the game come in, but there's a huge segment of people who are really like hardcore fans of strategy games, especially non-digital games, like the board game geek crowd. There's a certain percentage of board game geek players who will say, yeah, I don't like games with too much of that, because then it just becomes about that instead of about what games are supposed to be about, which is, I figured out the strategy. I understand the deep space of problem solving and in this game, so I can make the correct move and master it without ever having to think about the fact that there's a human being with personality who might be susceptible to my wetware hacking skills.
You can hack me any day.
I don't know, something I was just thinking about while you were saying this, how interesting it is that people like often forget how much like performance is a part of games, and how like, there's like the strategy stuff, but like also like you're saying how charming people are probably good at consentical, like, because it's just like a lot of it's just performance and how you're like performing the game as you're playing it, especially when it's like with two people and how you're kind of like interacting in that way. So I don't know, that's another interesting thing about this stuff, is that like performance is so good at like kind of getting people to be intimate in that way often, because it's like you were saying before, it kind of like, there's like that awkward phase, and like the performance aspect can either like play with that or make that easier. Like there's so many different interactions that can have. So it's pretty cool.
I'm gonna try this again. No, can I borrow that?
Yeah. Awesome, thank you. So why do you think it is that so many games aren't engaging with intimacy. So there are a couple theories, right? So Robert, you're talking about it's actually a hard technical problem. Naomi, you're saying we're fundamentally awkward as people who play a lot of games. We don't want to have to get into that intimacy, but you know, this is something you're wrestling with that is in some ways absent from a lot of games. So why aren't we doing more of this?
I think I'll talk about Nina's game, Sybil, a little bit. It's weird if I explain your own game to you. I'll talk about my own reaction, I guess. Then it's not me explaining. I would say it's like performing yourself and like putting yourself out there is sometimes like I get like stage fright. Like when I'm working like a character creator part of a game, for example, like. I don't want someone watching me create a character, because then it's like, oh, is that really who you want to be? And then I'm like, oh, sorry, no, I'll make them pink and purple hair and stuff. So it's like, there's like a vulnerability in it, in being intimate, I think, and that's kind of, and then video games sometimes don't always feel like a safe space, right? So you don't always feel safe to be vulnerable and put yourself out.
Yeah, I would definitely agree with that. I think part of, like, to build on that, part of the reason why people don't often make games that are, like, about intimacy in this way is that it's really, like, scary for most people. People always ask me, like, why do you make such personal games? How can you do it? Like, it sounds so scary, and, like, I've just done it so much that I'm really used to it, but, like, obviously it wasn't always that way. Like, it was pretty intimidating to, like, put myself out there like that. And I think that that's, like, pretty much the same for everyone. Like we've been saying, intimacy can, like, be, like, really awkward. Too. So like there's a lot of like just like human aspects to that where it's like it's hard to make games about things that you're scared of, you know? So I think that's definitely part of it.
Yeah, it's funny because you know it's, it would also be scary to be, you know, in the middle of a war shooting at you, right?
Yeah.
And it's like that's the kind of, oh, this is a scary situation that I have to imagine myself in that is part and parcel of games. But somehow there's something more difficult than more of yourself is involved. Like when we start crossing that boundary, the number of people who are willing to play role-playing games or LARPs where they really have to invest themselves in the character is just a lot smaller than people who are just willing to be embodied in a very puppet-like way, right? Where you go, oh, I'm just controlling this character who's getting shot at, but it feels totally safe for me. I can just be ensconced in my, you know, on my couch. So I think that just poses a challenge, right? People talk so much about how, oh, games are about overcoming problems and, you know, figuring out how to be a better person, at least if you're someone who's interested in games from that angle. And, you know, they're difficult and you master them, right? But we don't talk about this difficult stuff, which is maybe some of the most important human difficult stuff, how to be vulnerable, how to actually be yourself in a situation, or put part of yourself out there in the world. So I think there's tons of reasons why it hasn't been done, but those are also the, I think, you know, go back to the first question, like why we should be doing more of it.
So this idea of creating safety, do you feel like that relates to consent in your games? Because at least, Naomi, you talked about consent, Robert, your games involve consent. So I have to admit to being one of those people who played Hurt Me Plenty and was a good partner for the first three times or so and listened to myself safe word. And then I was like, I'm not gonna know what this game is really about until I push it too far. And totally ignored his safe word and got locked out of the game for, what is it, 17 days, 19 days, something like that?
You're a really bad person.
Yeah, no, I agree. I felt absolutely horrible. So I guess I'm just wondering where consent is in this whole picture.
This is a really, really hard question for me with consent to call. It took me a long time to even figure out what I think about it. Because the question operates at a few different levels. First of all, you kind of have to consent to playing a game to actually be playing it in some senses. There may be some cases where you could say, like, okay, you're forced to play a game. Most people would consider that less than ideal or terrible, you know, if like your family is like forcing you to play Monopoly on Sunday night. But yeah, so on one hand, I was like, well, there's always some consent going on if you are sitting down with someone else to play. And in the rules for consent, I make that really clear. Like, you have to ask the other person if they want to play with you, talk about what the game is about, decide to play together, decide what rules you're playing with, and so forth, just to call that out. And I also put a rule in that said, oh, you know, you can cancel a move at any time if you're not comfortable with it. So it's kind of a rule zero in that it doesn't really affect or interact with the rest of the game at all. It just means, yeah, you can stop whenever you want to. But then I was like, well, where's the consent in the actual heart of the game? And I kind of think I realized at some point after, in the last year or so, that it exists in the capacity for you to just fuck up. Kind of like in Robert's game, you can do that thing which you know is bad, where you're like, okay, I'm gonna hit this virtual putt harder than it has to be hit. And if Robert had made that impossible, right, it would be like, oh no, you're hitting it too hard, stop before it happens, right? He could have done that and made it a more safe, nicer game where there was no possibility of consent being violated, but then it wouldn't really be saying anything about consent. It would just be it might be a way of practicing, right? It would tell you like, oh no, you're not doing it, go back, do it again. But maybe that would be good in some ways if someone really had to learn, okay, how hard is too hard? It's a little difficult to say because it depends on the person being spanked. But so that possibility for failure, I think, is really important. If we go back to some more traditional ideas about games, so like, okay, that's one of the good reasons play exists, because we can screw up, do it with a virtual butt instead of a real butt, and that's much better. Or we can see, well, what happens, right? Especially for kids or for people who are just learning about spanking. It's good to be able to screw up, right? Be like, uh-oh, I'm not gonna get to spank that person for a couple weeks. And it can sound like a lot is really nervous about this. You can't just completely betray someone's trust in that game. But what you can do is encounter a ton of awkwardness, just not being able to communicate clearly about what you're trying to do. So it's a little bit of a softer lesson. You'd be like, oh, we screwed up. We're like not in sync with each other. I did something that you didn't want me to do, but it's not like you asked me, like I'm betraying your trust. It's just a lack of coordination and communication. So that felt like, it's still pretty valuable to be able to understand, like, oh, these kinds of things can happen in space, even if we've agreed to do this together, and that it's something that you can get better at as a human skill.
I like the point you made about consent, about how like multiplayer games do, like by definition, almost require consent. But then Hurt Me Plenty is weird in that it's a single player game.
Right, yeah. And NPCs rarely consent to what we're doing, so.
Right, NPCs actually have no rights, right? Actually, software has no rights, right? Like, you can delete Hurt Me Plenty off your computer at any time. And it can't like object to that or anything. And if it does object to it, we call that malware. That's like a virus.
Or Zach HK.
So I feel like you can also technically delete his memory of being abused, which is really messed up. But I think that's okay because you know it's wrong, kind of. And it's okay for you to explore that as long as it's not like another person, right? It's software, so maybe that's okay then? I don't know. Maybe you're not a bad person.
It's interesting. In my sub, it's really different. I just kind of was started thinking about this recently. In my stuff, I'm not usually using consent like mechanically, but it's kind of come up as a result of like the game's making people claim that they feel voyeuristic, especially with Sybil. Like in Sybil, like I was saying earlier, you like can like click around on this girl, my desktop from when I was 19, and you can like look through this like a folder on the desktop. The first desktop that you see is a folder like called selfies, and it's all these pictures of me that I took myself. And a lot of people like come away from that game being like, oh, I felt like kind of voyeuristic in the beginning, which I think is really interesting because that infers that they think I wasn't giving consent to them to look through my photos of me. Whereas, like, from my perspective, I'm like, yes, I did consent to that because I'm putting these like on purpose so that you can look through them, right? But it's been interesting hearing players come away like as if they have, like, I've not given them that consent. So I've been thinking about that a lot, and I find that kind of interesting. And that usually only kind of happens in the beginning when they're still kind of getting used to the idea of like playing as me and like playing as a character. Because by the end of the game, usually they're like, oh, I was playing like I was the character. So they kind of like ease into that, but often in the beginning they feel like they're like violating my boundaries in some way, which is kind of interesting.
That's super interesting, and I wonder whether it's a result of existing expectations about what's happening when you're sitting down to play a single player game, that like, oh, you're the one who's in control, you're the human being here, you get to decide what happens, when it ends, all this stuff, and then you have these NPCs that are like these lesser non-alive beings, and that, oh, like, I'm just gonna do whatever I want, and they have to take it. So can NPCs even consent at all? And what, who is this character, Nina, inside of the game? It's an interesting site because she's both you, the creator, and the person whose life is being documented, and a character. So I'm gonna guess that's maybe where the voyeuristic feeling comes from, because of the assumption of like, okay, if I sit down and I'm playing a game and I shoot somebody, or I'm spying on someone inside of a game, that you must be doing something non-consensual, right? Like, how could it be, unless the character talks directly to your character and says, hey, this is okay, right? As if nothing ever happened before that.
And I think a lot of it too is that the mechanic of like looking through someone else's computer is like such like a cultural no-no. Like, for example, like, you know, most people don't want other people just like looking through their phones, like picking up. That's why iPhones lock, right? Like, so that you can prevent people from like getting access to your personal stuff. So I think like people are kind of jarred by like, I'm like not locking the desktop from you in the game. Like, it's open for you to peruse. So I think that just being a mechanic that is like culturally unacceptable, like kind of also adds to that.
I think that kind of comes back to like questions of performance too, right? Are we performing as Nina, or are we performing as this like creeper on your computer,
yeah,
right? Is Nina hovering? Am I performing for Nina at the firehouse? Is she watching me do all this? Oh, I should close that photo, right? So I think it'll be really interesting to watch people play your game.
Yeah,
actually.
And people really don't like being watched when they play that. And how do you do it is even like, I've had people run away from that game because they're so embarrassed once they figure out what they're doing. So that kind of thing is interesting. And I'd be interested like how that works in consentical, because like there's a lot of watching going on in that game because you're both like negotiating all this stuff. So I can imagine like, also, it like depends on the type of person you are, I guess, like if you're more open to that kind of thing. So I think that the act of performing and the act of watching and like how the people in both positions feel about doing that is interesting.
Yeah, I expected consensical to be a huge failure on that front. And I sort of figured like, okay, a lot of people are just not going to play it. They're going to look at it and be like, I'm too scared to do this. And that does happen a fair amount, but I've actually been surprised. So consentical doesn't exist for sale yet. There's only a few copies in existence. And so it's mostly been played at events, like here. It was at IndieCade East and at the original Quarter exhibition, and at a couple other conventions and things like that. And I'm all surprised about how often people are willing to just sit down and play it. And I think, so I must have done something right, and I'm still trying to figure out what that was. I think part of it is that the artwork and the cards is not super explicit. And I was trying to steer away from this territory of sex games of the sort that you would go to a sex toy store and buy, where it's like a terrible pair of dice that one die has like body parts and the other die has actions. You're like, roll the dice, so I have to tickle your foot now, right? Which is not the kind of game, well, nobody should ever play in those games, just to be clear, but, because that's like the terrible type of like, well, we have awkwardness in trying to be intimate, so we're going to put a random number generator in between the two of us, and that's going to like make everything work better, that's why we have game design, to know that that's bad. But yeah, so I was trying to steer away from that, and so the cards aren't super explicit, there's no genitals, and you have these characters that you are you're piloting, right? You're saying like, okay, it's not me doing this. I'm not saying, hey, do you want me to tickle your foot now? Robert, I knew the answer is yes, Robert. Yeah. This one still works? Thanks. Instead you have these characters who are doing the actions to each other, and that provides you with some distance. I think that might be part of why people are actually going to play it. I thought for a while that it was because people were drunk, but then it was played at the Museum of the Moving Image during the day, and I saw like little kids play with each other. I don't think the little kids understood what was going on. But yeah, people were playing it and kind of giggling and getting embarrassed. And it was just the right level of embarrassed, right? It didn't go over that threshold where they had to back away. I guess people are willing to do embarrassing things. That's what makes a lot of games, especially games that are played in public or party games, work, right? Because it gives you permission to do something stupid, like twist your body around someone else's body or to put your right foot on red. Thanks, Twister.
Thanks. So, one thing that all of your games have in common, it seems to me, or at least a game that each of you has worked on has in common, is that you make sex really weird, or you kind of like uncover the weirdness of sex, right? So something like succulent, it's freaky, right? Like, it gets freaky. It just does. Or the strangeness of how do you do it, right? Where you can't quite get them into a position that looks like people might normally have sex in. So I'm wondering about this strangeness of sex and how is sex part of intimacy? Like, does it have to be part of the intimacy? Or is there something about making sex weird that's valuable?
So are you, I'm trying to understand the question, are you saying that sex is not weird?
No, I'm saying that your games do something awesome by showing us just how weird sex is. And I think that in a lot of other games that maybe attempt to represent sex or attempt to represent intimacy, there's a like sincerity or an attempt at realism that falls really flat and feels really cheesy. And I wonder, you're like, what's the value in doing something kind of absurd?
Yeah, I mean, I think of that as just ripping some more of that veil away, right? Because like that Robert pointed out about porn, it's easy, it's fun. It usually makes sex look like, oh, it's like so awesome and straightforward and, that there's never any like awkward, super messed up problems. Nobody's usually vomiting on each other or anything like that. So I don't know. I think it's a type of realism, I suppose. I'm not usually a huge fan of realism, but I'm more a fan of realism than just replicating existing fantasies about romantic love and sex and how it's so beautiful. And I think my experience as a queer person is kind of useful here because there's this, old, decades-old idea of like, oh, when two women have sex, it's like you touch each other like you're a mirror, and like, oh, your left hand touches my left hand. And then we do all the same things, and it's just a beautiful coming together of completely equal, exactly identical people. And that's like one of the oldest jokes, queer jokes in the books. That's not what sex is like at all, right? So we have all of these existing deeply stupid cultural ideas about sex and love, and why not show how weird it is?
I think intimacy doesn't necessarily require sex. I think that was one of the questions you asked. But I just use sex because it's the only weapon powerful enough to overcome graphic violence in video games. Sex is the only thing like dirty and disgusting and beautiful and sexy enough, I guess. I also really like realism because it makes weird stuff weirder. Like, have we all seen Skate 3 videos on YouTube? Do yourself a favor and do that after the talk. And they're really great because it's kind of realistic, but then you see all these bodies doing these impossible things, and then it's just really absurd, and it highlights the absurdity, and then suddenly it's kind of this like really magical kind of effect, I feel.
Thanks.
I feel like, Robert, with your games, it's really interesting. I know when we talked really briefly about this, but in your games, it's like, I found that like your presentation is very like aggressively about sex. Like, you know, you're very upfront, whereas like with my stuff, I'm usually like kind of easing the player into it rather than kind of like putting it like straight up front. And I find that really interesting about your stuff.
I admire like your subtlety and stuff, like an artistic nuance. I think my games, yeah, are aggressive. They're inspired a lot by like music videos and like pop, and I do want to emphasize, I guess, like the friction. I do like the word friction. Like you see all this sexy stuff happening, and then suddenly his like face explodes and he wants to eat your soul or something, right? That's what happens in Succubus, spoiler. So it's like, I don't know, yeah, I guess I just like that aspect of it, I guess. It's like sexy, but then it's like, oh no, that's not sexy at all.
I wonder if this is like some aspect of the truth is stranger than fiction principle, right? This fictional sex is smooth, fictional violence is usually simpler than real violence too, right? And fictional bodies are made of fewer polygons than real bodies, right? But as we, I think what you're saying about realism is really interesting, as we have more polygons in virtual worlds, the bodies get much weirder, like the kinds of things that can happen. You can tell me if I'm totally wrong about that from a technical standpoint, but yeah, sort of, right, but that's the cool thing about Skate 3, right, or Cobra Club, that the bodies start to do really weird things, and so that it not only exposes the fact that, okay, we're in this kind of weird simulacra, but maybe it's more true on a couple levels. It's like, no, this is the truth of polygons and meshes deforming. And it's also, maybe it points back to, you know, oh, you know, our bodies aren't anything like these fantasies. Our bodies are weird and yeah. Exactly.
I wonder, so to be talking about realism and reality, it feels like I have to ask about VR and whether you find that there's something maybe interesting in VR. For example, I don't know if you've watched any of the reaction videos of people watching VR porn. If you haven't watched those, I highly recommend them. People freak out and say things like, I'm never touching another human being again. I will always have sex like this forever. I think VR is really interesting right now because a large portion of people want it to be the future. I think there's a sizable portion of people who want to stay skeptical. And I wonder if you have any thoughts about bringing this kind of intimacy and design into VR.
I think I like VR because I feel like it's really broken in a lot of ways, and that's what's kind of great about it, and that's what means it's like kind of telling the truth despite like the VR industry's best efforts. I feel like I wouldn't want to watch VR porn because now I'm like wearing this giant blindfold over my face. Like, well, if someone comes into the room or something, I'll be so like mortified. I don't know, and then I think I don't want like it would be cool to have like a dick strapped to your face, but I don't know. But it's kind of weird that it's kind of cool that I don't know, so maybe I will explore that, I don't know.
So I've been thinking about there are difficulty levels in Consentical that have to do with how literally you communicate with each other. The easiest one, which you can use as a practice game or to practice ideas about consent communication, is just that you talk with each other while you're playing. But all of the higher difficulty levels mean you can't just talk about what cards you're going to play. You have to communicate non-verbally or with your eyes. And so I'm thinking the hardest difficulty level is that you play Consentical and you are wearing an Oculus Rift. And that's it.
Are the Oculus Rifts like plugged into anything, or is it just
they're plugged into a webcam that so you're watching yourself play?
It occurs to me, Naomi, you were saying that when we represent sex in porn or in games, we don't often have messy things like we vomit at each other, right? But VR, as you may well know, causes nausea pretty consistently, especially in women. And so I wonder if that would be a great opportunity to connect reality and sexy vomiting.
I mean, I'm not sure. I was never sure about motion control and other sort of technological innovations for games, and I kind of feel like VR is maybe an unstoppable juggernaut at some point in the near future. So I think one of the things we can do as responsible game designers is prepare everyone for how horrible that world will be by saying, like, no, you have to practice figuring out how to communicate with someone else when you are watching yourself do something and everyone has these things strapped on their faces. Because if we can start kids working on that now, then it may not be too late for humanity.
I actually saw an article by Addie Robertson, I think on The Verge, about this really great VR peripheral where you snap it to the bottom of the VR headset, so it like covers the bottom of your face. So it's kind of like suffocating you, but it's also like pumping smell particles at you, but then there's also like these weird things that like spray mist at you. So you have this weird like fluid all over your face and you're suffocating and it smells like plastic or something. And there's like fans in there or something. It just sounds really terrible and promising.
This point you made earlier, Nina, about intimacy, right? You said, I want a lot of detail in my games about me, because I think that it will be a more intimate experience if my players can really see me as a person, right? Like, it's not them, they're not projecting, it's me as a person. But I wonder, I don't know, to me it seems like there's a different kind of intimacy that's maybe just as valuable, that's about, like, merging with the game versus being a person who relates to the game. So I wonder if you see a space for people to become you.
Yeah, and that's what I mean when I say player character embodiment. Is like during the time of the game, my goal is usually to have the player come out of the experience feeling like they stepped into my shoes for like a moment. But I think it's always important to acknowledge that there's like, yeah, there's that kind of intimacy where you're like embodying me or the character in the game. But there's also the intimacy just gained from like understanding me or the character. So I think there's like multiple layers of intimacy there, where it's like during the time that like you're playing the game and you're like engaging with the mechanics, you're like playing as me, and then you come away with it and you can more intimately understand me. So those are like sort of like two parts of it, I guess, for me.
I feel like you're like invoking some concept of like layers,
yeah.
Kind of, right? And I think that's kind of how I see how my games operate a little bit too. Like when I show Succulent, like the first layer will be like someone looking at it and their eyes bulge out and then they walk away. Like that's like the first layer, and then the second layer is like people getting really into it and stuff. I feel like we should like kind of, I guess, like scaffold our games for like different levels of intimacy. I think that works really well.
Yeah, and I guess that's kind of what I was trying to do with difficulty levels and Consentical too, that you know, you can just, as you're getting used to both the system of the game and the experience, you can just talk with people about it, and that feels like a pretty easy experience. But then as you step up, you actually have to start licking your own body. That's you kind of have to do that to play at the higher difficulty levels in Consentical, or just I've seen a lot of players lick themselves, which is kind of feels like a real success for me as a designer. And or you're just like really trying to stare someone in the eyes, and that's just more difficult. I guess the question of embodiment is really different with that game, but that's one of the things that I really like about Stick Shift. Is that it kind of is asking you to get really intimate with not a character but a car, right? So it feels more like it's this mechanical thing that that represents like I'm getting intimate with this game. And when you said, we're saying that it was an autoerotic game, I also thought that was hilarious, not just because of the pun, but because I mean I really thought, and maybe I was. Man, I was giving you too much credit. That what you meant was that, you know, are the car and the driver actually different entities in this world, or
sure. Let's say I said that.
that they are different entities. Well, I don't like that, so I don't care what anybody thinks. I think they're kind of the same thing. Like, right, so this guy's like, he's like jerking on the stick shift, right? So, and he's piloting this car around, and like when you, and actually you're the one who's pointed out, like, the tricks that 3D games use, when you're moving around a virtual world as a car, you're not like a human being inside of a car. You've been changed into a car, right? So, I don't know, I always thought that that's kind of what the autoeroticism was about, was that you're jerking this car off, but you're also the car at the same time. So there's embodiment there that's also intimacy because you're jerking your own virtual self off.
Yeah.
Cool.
No, that sounds good.
Yeah, game analysis done.
Great. Any final thoughts before we wrap up?
Sex is cool.
It's in our games a lot.
Yes, it is.
Bodies are weird.
The magic circle is just an excuse for us to pretend that we ourselves are not in space.
Amen.